The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty.
Welcome to Majesty. My name is Ron McKinney. I'm Pastor Kinsey Drive Baptist Church in Dalton, Georgia. And I'm pleased that you're watching today, and I want to give you something from God's Word that will be of benefit to you, and hopefully it will be encouraging to you if you're a child of God. If you don't know Jesus Christ in a saving way, that today you might even be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit and come to this saving knowledge of who He is. I'd like to mention something in terms of what we're going to speak about today. First of all, I want to mention that we're living in what we would call perilous times. This is a strange time in the history not only of our country, but I would say of the world, in terms of just being very perilous. There are wars that are going on. There are terrorist attacks that we don't know anything, where they're coming from and when they will happen. We're really kind of just anticipating something. And all of this causes us to have a fear. A fear is something that is very paralyzing. It causes men and women and even boys and girls to be in such a state that they don't know what to do. And it causes confusion. It causes men and women to have times of just complete breakdown and not knowing what to do or what to say. And yet, one of the things that I know is the Bible teaches me that we can have, as Christians, a tremendous hope during the time of peril, the time when there is so much confusion and chaos in the world. I'm thankful that I know this, that this world is not my home. I'm a pilgrim that's passing through. I heard someone say earlier today as I was listening to the radio that we are strangers and foreigners. I could use the term, we are refugees in this land. This is not our home. I'm not looking to have a place here that's going to be my final destination. I know that someday I'm going to be with the Lord and I can look forward to that. I'm laying up treasures in heaven, where moth and rust doth not corrupt and thieves cannot break through and steal. I want to lay up thing in heaven, not anything that's temporal that down here that has any real interest to me and that has anything that would hold me to this world. My friend, if you're trying to just get all the toys that you can and gather in all the possessions you can and you live for this world and the things of this world, you're going to be very disappointed. You're going to be disappointed because they don't bring satisfaction. They don't bring you to a place of having a sense of joy. But what I was talking about earlier is that this fear that comes to paralyze us. If you have your Bible, I'm going to look for a moment here in Acts chapter 18, verses 9 and 10, because in the midst of fear, in the midst of hardship, in the midst of trouble, of trial, we can have a sense of knowing that God is with us. Listen to these words in Acts chapter 19 and verse 9. He said, "Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision." You know that Paul had, there were six visions that we find in the Bible, which the Lord came to the Apostle Paul and spoke to him. And he came to him at night by vision, and he said, "Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace." All right, here's some instruction that the Lord was given giving to Apostle Paul. Now, we don't think of Apostle Paul as being someone who is afraid, and yet our Lord says here, be not afraid. Now, if he hadn't have said that, we know that Paul then must have been afraid. And how could he be afraid? This man whom we consider as being so bold, a man who could speak in front of many people there on Mars Hill as he was preaching the gospel, and he calls about the Acropolis as he looks up and he talks about the many gods that they had, and down before him he could see the forum and all of the things that are around him, and he was preaching the gospel with power and under the demonstration of the Holy Spirit, as it says in 1 Thessalonians. This is a man who was bold, is a man who was determined. He was fearless in my eyes. I guess I would say I have a view of him as being on a pedestal. And yet we must remember this, he's made of the same stuff you and me are made of. He's made of flesh and blood and bone. He was a man. He was a human being, and he struggled, as we find, with the same things that we struggle with. He says this in 1 Corinthians. He said, I've been distressed, and he said, and I come to you in fear and trembling. Now that's not someone that has this kind of self-confidence that we kind of think that he must have had. No, the Apostle Paul was struggling with fear. And now, why would he be fearful? Well, he just left Athens, and there he had been persecuted. He had been slandered. He went in so many ways. It was time that he must leave there. And so he takes the journey some 50 miles or whatever it is down to Corinth. Now, Corinth was an interesting place. According to what we read, people like Josephus, and who's a historian who wrote about the Corinthians, they were wicked and ungodly people. In fact, from what we see in the scriptures themselves, they were people who, they were very immoral, particularly sexually immoral, according to what the Bible teaches. They were homosexual. And they did other things that we don't like to even mention. But I'm saying this was a very, very wicked city. And he knew that going into Corinth, there was going to be opposition. How do you feel when you get into a situation? I'm talking about you that are Christians. How do you feel when you confront somebody and they don't just say, well, you know, I believe just like you do, and I accept the gospel, and I believe in the Bible. No, they began to attack you. They began to confront you. And many young people, when they go off to college after having been in their home church for all these years growing up and hearing the stories about Jesus and about creation and so forth, and the first encounter that they have in college is the professor begins to say, it's nothing about creation. There's no creator. And they don't have, you know, you can't hold to that sort of thing. And they start talking about evolution and how everything has evolved from some kind of slime billions and billions of years ago. Now, I'm telling you, for a person who is in that situation, there's a sense of fear that can come. Fear and trembling. And I mean by that, it is paralyzing. It keeps people from being bold and speaking out. And unless you were a mature Christian, you probably have great difficulty with that. Because you must know that you have to rely upon the grace and the mercy of God to be able to speak in those kind of situations. And even the Apostle Paul finds himself in this situation. He's about to go into Corinth. And the Lord comes to him in vision and speaks to him and says, don't be afraid. And in fact, he says to him, continue speaking. Don't be silent. Well, we know the first thing that happens to us in our weakness, the weakness of our flesh, is we get very quiet. We don't want to speak. We want to go off to a corner. And yet, he tells him to continue to speak. Now listen to what else he says. Verse 10 of chapter 18 of Acts, he says, "For I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for have much people in this city." Well, here are three statements that are made, are given to him by the Lord. Now, this is the Lord speaking here. And this is what he says to Paul. He says, "For I am with thee." Well, this is a promise. This is a promise of the Father that he gives. He gives us this promise that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Oh, I love this because over the years, I find myself sometimes in difficult situations. I find myself sometimes where it is not favorable. I mean, not everyone accepts the message that I preach. Not everyone accepts the position that I would hold in certain areas in terms of not only the gospel, but probably even in political realms. And so consequently, I find myself in a place where there is a lot of opposition and there are people who don't want to hear and they don't believe. And so what happens is my native response, that is, as a man, my response is to want to pull back. He says here, continue speaking, don't be silent. And then he says, the reason why is because I am with you. I am with you. Now think about that for a moment. Here is a promise. In fact, I would say this is a pledge that was given to the Apostle Paul that I want you to remember this when you find yourself having a sense of fear, of not knowing what to really do. He says, what I'm telling you, he says, I want you to remember this. You remember that I'm with you. You ever have those moments in your life? I'm talking to those that are Christians. If you're a non-Christian, then you certainly don't even have this kind of experience. You wouldn't know what I'm talking about. You may long to know what I'm talking about, and I can tell you, you can have that through Jesus Christ because he gives us the assurance that he's with us. He's ever present with his children. He cares for us as a loving Heavenly Father. He delights in being with us and his presence being with us. Oftentimes when I go to the hospital, I go to visit those that are Christians. One of the things that I remind them of is that you're not alone as you lie here in this bed. You're not alone. God comes and he is with you in this place. You have that soldier that goes to the foreign land and he's there under attack. He needs to remind himself, I'm not alone. My God is with me. And even I know our Lord, he gives us ample reasons for us to rejoice because of his presence. And more than anything, I think a Christian delights in the presence of the Lord. Remember, he said to the disciples and to those as he left, as he went, had the ascension, and he talks about this in chapter 28 of Matthew as he ascends up to heaven. And he says to them, he says, do not be afraid. He says, don't be afraid because I am with you to the end, to the very end. That Jesus is saying, his presence is with us. I am with you. And then let's see what else he says here. He says, not only, he says, for I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee. Well, now that's an interesting statement that is made here to the Apostle Paul. Now, this is the Apostle Paul whom we know. He was beaten and left for dead several times, in fact. We know also that he was stoned, left for dead. He was in and out of every prison, of every city practically that he preached the gospel. He was thrown in prison because of it. He was shipwrecked. This is a man who's been through every kind of hardship that you might imagine. And he describes it for us. He gives us a list of the things that have happened to him. In fact, tradition tells us that his body was so bent and racked with pain and that he hardly resembled that of a man because he had been through so many hardships. And here he says a promise. He says, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee. In other words, there's no one that's going to be able to touch you. You're not going to have any problems here. Now we don't take this and say, well, now that means that we're never going to have anything happen to us. Well, we already have recited some of the things that happened to the Apostle Paul. He'd already been through this. But what he's telling them, when you go into Corinth, he says, no man's going to be able to hurt you. In other words, when God has a plan and purpose for Paul, for him to accomplish a mission, he tells him, no one's going to hurt you. I know that there have been missionaries who have gone to foreign fields. And they've gone into places where more than likely they would easily have been martyred. And of course, we have in church history many, many, many men and women, boys and girls, in fact, who have been martyred for the cause of Jesus Christ. But on the other hand, there have been others that have gone in, and God has spared them and it made it possible for them to preach the gospel. I've got an example in my dear friend David Sitton. And David Sitton was in Papua New Guinea, and he was among a tribe of cannibals, and he spent a couple years there in which he lived among them in order to get to know them. And then there came the breakthrough where the man who was the medicine man, the witch doctor, I guess you would say, that he came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and he was baptized. And then the whole tribe practically came to faith in Jesus Christ. But during that time, I remember he talks about having Machete Bob, is what we call him. He put a machete to the throat of David Sitton and he was going to slit it. And he spared his life. And what we know is that God was doing that. That was the Lord who was protecting him, watching over him. And he had many other experiences like that. And I can tell you, God is one who says, I will protect you and watch. In other words, if I have a purpose in what you're doing and I send you to do that, he says, you go in the name of Jesus Christ, knowing that he will protect you. He'll make it possible. And if he doesn't, in other words, if your life is taken, we know this, that it is in God's plan and his purpose. He has a reason for it. All things work together for good to those that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. It's his will. How wonderful it is to know that he will care for us and protect us. But now remember, this is a general principle, and it's not something that he says we will never have physical harm to come to us, because we know there are times that God even uses that for his glory and praise. Well, there's a third thing that's mentioned here. Let's look at it in verse 10. The third one is, he says, for I have much people in this city. Now, the Lord is encouraging Paul as he has fear of going into this wicked city of Corinth to preach the gospel. And he tells him, continue speaking. He says, don't be quiet, don't be silent. And then he gives him these three things. The first one was that I will be with you. That's the presence of the Lord. Boy, I can tell you, there are times when I've just praised God for His presence. And then the second thing we see here, that He says, He will not hurt you. They will not hurt you. And then the third thing is, I have much people in this city. Now, what does He mean by that? Well, He's talking about God's people, God's elect. Before Paul goes into Corinth, he's told this. He says, you're going to have some people who will actually believe in your message. They're going to hear you. One of the glorious things of being a missionary, but even being a preacher of gospel just like I am, I have this joyful thought that when I preach the gospel, it's not in vain. I know that God is going to use that for His glory, that there are going to be those that are going to hear, and they're going to listen, and they're going to receive that message. Why? It's because God has prepared them. He's opened their heart. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That Word that's preached and taught, He says, what it does by the Holy Spirit is He opens the heart and the mind to receive the glorious gospel concerning Jesus Christ. He says there are much people in this city. Now let me tell you something. This is a subject of election. You know, that God chose whom He will save before the foundation of the world. Lest anyone think that's just my thoughts, remember this is Scripture, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4. For we were chosen in Him, that is in Christ Jesus, before the foundation of the world, in order that we might be to the glory of God. He has chosen His people. He has set His affection upon them before the world was made. Oh, that seems to be very difficult for some to receive, but the Scripture is so clear that He did this in order that He would have a people. You see, because all of us are in sin, and it's necessary the Spirit of God come and draw us to Himself. But He does it because it's His people. He calls Him. And so Paul, before he goes into Corinth, he's given this word. I have many people in that city. They're going to hear your gospel. What's the most wonderful thing you can hear if you're a preacher of the gospel or if you're a missionary? It is that there are going to be those that are going to hear and they will listen. They will receive that. You know, the word does not return to him void. It's going to accomplish exactly what God meant for it to accomplish. I was talking to some folks just the other day, and we were talking about how God worked in their life. This particular gentleman that I was speaking with, he and his wife and their children, and we were talking, but he was telling me how he came to Christ. He wasn't looking for him, but he was telling how providentially he was brought to a place where he heard the gospel preached and he heard the truth concerning Jesus Christ. And we know what takes place. The Holy Spirit gives him spiritual life. That's regeneration, the quickening of the life, giving them the life to believe in order that they might come before the Lord and call upon His name. As Jesus says, come unto me, All ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. There's rest in Christ. This is what happened to this young man. But he was talking about the providential things that happened in order that the door was open for him to hear the gospel and then to believe the gospel. All those circumstances were not by chance, but by purpose. I'm old enough now, I can look back and very clearly see the handprint of God on so many things that took place in my life that I never really understood. But now I can see, you know, God, you were in that, how you worked and how you made it possible for me to go to this school and this person that I met. And as things went about and my life began to mature, there are all these things that God was working in my life that would be for my good and to be to His glory and praise. Unless you think that I'm talking about something that I've done, I give glory to God because He works it all in His purpose and plan. This is what Paul understood. Yes, there was fear, but his fear was taken care of. Now he had this confidence that God was with him, and the fact he would not be hindered, or there would be no harm come to him, and then that there would be many who would hear him as he preaches the gospel. I pray for you today that you might know the true and the living God, for in Him there is eternal life. It is in believing in the one and only true God and Jesus Christ whom He has sent. Let us pray together. Father, thank You today for Your mercy that You've shown to us in Jesus Christ, that before the foundation of the world, You chose a people to love You and serve You. Oh, Father, I pray that You would call them out even now by the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it's in His name we pray. Amen. I want to ask you to write to me or to call to me. The address is on the screen, Kinsey Drive Baptist Church, 2626 Kinsey Drive, Dalton, Georgia, 30720, or call 706-277-3505. I'll send you a copy of this magazine. Till next week at the same time, may God richly bless you.
He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves.